John Murray Press presents Avoiding Anxiety in Autistic Adults, a guide to autistic well-being. Written and read by Dr. Luke Beardon.
1. Autistic Anxiety. Anxiety. At best, it makes for a pretty miserable day. At worst, it kills. Make no mistake, this is no hyperbole, no exaggeration, no fabrication. The kind of ongoing, perpetuating, seemingly never-ending, dark, intense, consuming anxiety that can pervade the lives of autistic adults has the capacity to cripple a person's well-being and disastrously impact on mental and physical health. The long-term impact of ongoing anxiety cannot be underestimated. To wake up with the knowledge that you're anxious and to go to bed knowing that the same anxiety will stave off sleep or intrude on dreams with no certainty as to when the cycle will ever end is to lead a desolate and distressing existence. If you are an autistic adult reading this who does not recognise yourself in these opening words, fantastic. I hope that you continue in an anxiety-free world. If you are an autistic adult who recognises at least in part some of these words, then I reach out to you through this book in the hope that it might in some way help alleviate aspects of your anxiety. If you are a person reading this to better understand autistic anxiety, possibly, or hopefully, to better understand someone you care about and or support them, then please take this introduction seriously. Anxiety is a state that one might find oneself in for any number of reasons. Sometimes it's a myriad of combined factors that lead to anxiety. Sometimes it can be a very specific trigger that is identifiable. Whatever the reason, anxiety cannot ever be underestimated in terms of the devastating impact that it can have on a human, which is why it needs to be taken so seriously. Fear, frustration, confusion, interaction, the sensory environment, the unknown, any one of these, and the list could be extended multiple times, can lead to acute anxiety. It's rarely an easy area to circumnavigate and understand. If it was, then it wouldn't be a problem. And it really is a huge problem. There are statistics relating to autistic anxiety that demonstrate that you are far more likely to be anxious than the PNT. And for many adults, anxiety can be a diagnosable pathological psychiatric state. And yet I wonder if those statistics are even close to the reality. One of the issues that so many of you face is that having been in a constant state of anxiety for much or even all of your life, it becomes such a norm that you don't necessarily consider that life could be any different. I've known plenty of adults who don't know that they are in a more anxious state than the rest of the population because it has never occurred to them. We could be living in a world where there are far more anxious autistic adults than research has identified, not least because many of those adults remain unidentified anyway. Before I continue, I shall explain my terms. I means me. My views have developed through many years of being allowed to share the lives of autistic people. I also happen to live a pretty autism-focused life, as autism is my job and has been, on and off, since I first knowingly came across autism as a volunteer in a special school, aged 14. I would consider myself a practice-based academic, for want of a better phrase. I am absolutely not an autism expert. No one is. Some people will be experts in a particular area of autism, a particular age group, a particular person. You may well be an expert in your own autistic self. But as the numbers of autistic people are so vast, and the range of how autism impacts on each individual at any one time is infinite, my belief is that to claim expertise in a population that is so prolific would be an indication that, in reality, the claimant is far from being an expert simply by claiming to be one. However, I have been fortunate enough to share the lives of many autistic people over many years, directly and indirectly, and each day that goes by adds just a little more to my understanding. Most books written about autistic people write about you. I do not intend to do that. You are the centre of this narrative, you being the autistic person. Many of you will have been othered to the point of it being the norm, which in itself can be a cause of anxiety. Yes, being autistic by definition is to be different to the majority. but it is by no means to be lesser, which is often how the autism narrative is presented. I do not subscribe to this notion, so you means the autistic reader. I will also refer to autistic adults in the third person. This is more to assist with narrative flow than anything else. However, it is also a necessity when including examples of real life. Note, I use the term autistic as opposed to with autism. As with neurodiversity, there is much debate as to which should be the preferred term. History can clearly demonstrate movement in this regard, which is both refreshing and somewhat depressing simultaneously. It used to be the case that there was a very clear dictate that using the identity-first term autistic, as opposed to the person-first term with autism, was not the done thing. The insinuation being that being referred to as autistic was a negative. When I first started my academic journey, this rule was extremely clear. However, in recent years, there's plenty of evidence that autistic adults far prefer the identity-first autistic to ascribe to their autistic self. Research papers, as well as the plethora of Twitter polls, I read one the other day with over 6,000 responses, 91% choosing identity first language, as well as blogs of autistic adults, show a very clear preference. This is extremely refreshing. The fact that many authors are actually listening to the autistic population and changing their language use is hugely encouraging. What is less encouraging is the ongoing narrative that does not take these preferences into account. It should also be noted that while the majority of individuals prefer identity first, there is a significant minority who are happy with either term, or specifically align with person first language. Many authors will use terms such as neurotypical and neurodiverse. These are perhaps more complex than one might think. Some will refer to non-neurotypical individuals, for example, as neurodiverse, when neurodivergent is the accurate term. After all, one individual cannot be of multiple neurologies. A population is, of course, neurodiverse, an individual is not. This may sound pedantic, however, it is a good illustration as to the sometimes subtle ableist language that perpetuates literature relating to autism that leads to anxiety. If one is constantly exposed to language of deficit and comparison, then it is likely that this will have a negative effect on one's mindset. The idea that there is one right way of being within neurological function, and to differ from that norm is somehow to be lesser, is a notion that needs to be challenged in the strongest terms within the autism world. The reality is that it is a biological fact that the entire human race is neurodiverse, but there are groups of individuals within that diversity that can be seen and understood within different paradigms, neurodivergent and autistic being two of those groups. All autistic individuals, by definition, will be neurodivergent. Not all neurodivergent individuals will be autistic. My preference, rather than neurotypical, based on an email sent to me by an autistic adult who I was lucky enough to know, is predominant neurotype, abbreviated to PNT. So, to be clear, the PNT by statistical definition would not be autistic. This is how I will refer to the population who are not autistic, while absolutely accepting that there will be wonderful pockets of humanity whereby the PNT is actually autistic. I am also acknowledging that within the PNT population, there will also be neurodivergent individuals who are also not autistic. However, as this book is about autistic anxiety and not specifically the neurodiversity paradigm or movement, I shall leave those debates at that. I apologise for being so binary about this, and absolutely understand and accept that the neurodiversity of the human race is far more complex than this scant section indicates. The other aspect that might be useful to include here is that those who are not autistic but who experience severe levels of anxiety, for whatever reason, might also find some of this narrative of benefit. So, back to my opening section. You will notice that I have included the term autistic anxiety. I should be absolutely clear here. There is no ownership over anxiety. It is not the sole domain of the autistic population by any stretch of the imagination. After all, anyone can be anxious. And some of the PNT will at times be just as anxious as any autistic person. But I genuinely believe that there is, in the main, a qualitative difference between your way of experiencing anxiety and the anxiety experienced by the PNT. This will not always be the case, but for most of the PNT compared to most of you, there will be less overall ongoing anxiety, less frequency, less duration, less intensity, and fewer days during which anxiety is experienced. The reason for this, in a sense, is somewhat simple, but is a notion that can go an awful long way in ascertaining what we need to do about autistic anxiety. Apologies for repeating myself, as I have written and spoken about this several times before, but it comes back to what I refer to as the golden equation. Autism plus environment equals outcome. What this means is that being autistic in and of itself means nothing aside from the fact that you are autistic. It literally cannot go any further than that in relation to outcome. All of those statistics around what being autistic means are up for debate until that statistic is 100%, i.e. when a specific outcome for all autistic individuals is identical. There is very little that can fall into this category. If you try to complete the sentence, all autistic people will definitively, you will soon discover that there are very few endings that can be applied that are relevant to all autistic adults. In fact, and while I don't want to contradict the purpose of this book, it is crystal clear that being autistic is not the same as being anxious. Otherwise, all autistic people would, presumably, be anxious all of the time, which is absolutely not true. It would be just as valid to acknowledge that there are some autistic people who very rarely experience anxiety. However, I still maintain that being autistic in an environment that is unsuited to you will lead to far greater risks of high anxiety. The problem that so many of you will know about is that the environment is so often unsuited, in which case the probability is that there is a higher risk of anxiety. I could argue, in fact I do argue, that there is a direct correlative link between the levels of environmental suitability and the levels of anxiety that are likely to be experienced. Simply, the more suitable the environment, the less the likelihood that you will be anxious. So, what do I mean by environment? Categorising loosely, there are three main components that impact on the environment within the above equation. These are the three main areas. I am by no means suggesting that they are exclusive. So, the three main components are 1. People. 2. The physical environment. 3. Systems. For example, policy, strategy, or legislation. If we get all of the above right, in terms of reflecting your individual need, then the chances are your anxiety will take a back seat. Unfortunately, as you will no doubt be aware, these ideal circumstances are few and far between. The main point I am making here is that it is the environment that is the biggest influence over your anxiety, not you. There may be things that you as an individual might be able to do to impact on your anxiety, but most of the time your anxiety will stem from the environment, not from within yourself. So the focus should be on changing whatever the cause is within the environment, rather than the focus purely being on you. This book is not intended, therefore, to be a self-help manual for you. That would be beyond patronising at best. It does, however, seek to identify what might potentially be causing your anxiety in order for something to be done about it. In fact, while this book is directly written to you, it could be that, if it is to be of benefit to you, it should be read by others around you who may have influence over your environment. When I came up with the idea for this book, I was hoping for it to be a guide to some of the pitfalls that you might encounter through adulthood and possible ways to avoid them. I hope that there will still be some elements of this within the chapters, but actually, so many of the anxiety-inducing experiences that you will have faced are so dependent on others that much of this book has been taken over by suggestions for how others might change their practice in order for you to lead a stress-free adulthood. While there are some aspects of life that you have total control of, and some aspects that you might have partial control of, there are still many areas that are beyond your control. Therefore, it is vital that the general population understands what many of the issues are and is educated to respond accordingly. It should not simply be down to you to work out what the solutions are and to implement them. The way in which I've gone about writing this book is to identify some key areas that are likely to be a part of your life and to subsequently indicate what aspects of those could cause anxiety. I will also make suggestions as to what might change in order to reduce some of those effects. These suggestions are not legally binding, but they do have the legislation of the Equality Act in mind. The Equality Act recognises autism as a disability, and therefore there is a legal duty to take the following types of discrimination into account. The following information came in part from the internet, specifically the Citizens Advice Bureau. Direct discrimination is when an institution acts less favourably towards you as a result of you being autistic. An example of this might be an employer who decides that you should not be shortlisted for a job because you are autistic. Indirect discrimination is when you are disadvantaged because the policy, or similar, is applied in the same way, not taking your autism into account. An example of this might be that you are forced into sharing the same sensory experience that could have been avoided, which puts you at a disadvantage. Discrimination arising out of a disability is when you are treated unfavourably as a result of something specific to how autism impacts on you. An example might be that you need to have time to process information following a colleague's presentation prior to joining the Q&A session, but are not given the time to do so. Reasonable adjustments are to be put in place to ensure that you are not put at a substantial disadvantage as a result of being autistic compared to others. I will be giving examples of what might be considered reasonable adjustments throughout the rest of the book. There is no clear definition as to what a reasonable adjustment actually is, though there are guidelines. This is a positive and a negative. Positive in that it recognises just how individual some of your adjustments need to be, but problematic as there are grey areas around what needs to be lawfully provided or changed and what doesn't. The examples I will give take the following into account as per the guidelines: changing the way things are done, changing the physical environment, and the provision of additional aids and/or services. There is not an unlimited resource for those under the Act to provide adjustments, so there are other considerations that need to be taken into account. For example, the information from Citizens Advice is as follows. Adjustments only have to be made if it's reasonable to do so. What's a reasonable thing to ask for depends on things like your disability, how practicable the changes are, if the change you ask for would overcome the disadvantage you and other disabled people experience, the size of the organisation, how much money and resources are available, the cost of making the changes, and if any changes have already been made. I will endeavour to remain within these guidelines throughout the book, but do take note that I am not a solicitor. The rationale behind including what might be considered reasonable adjustments in a book on autism and anxiety is that I fully believe that a lot of the anxiety that is experienced by you could be avoided if the Equality Act was adhered to on an individual basis, with an understanding of individual autistic need. Consider the following scenarios as examples of reasonable adjustments that have made a massive difference to the individual. Alan is an academically standout student who has completed his PhD thesis and is ready to prepare for his viva voce. The viva has been allocated a room by the university's room booking team, and despite Alan being known to the university as being autistic, the room has bright fluorescent lights, two clocks, both of which have audible ticks, and is adjacent to the cleaning cupboard, which has strong-smelling disinfectant. Alan has sensory sensitivities as a result of being autistic that include a strong aversion to fluorescent lights, which give him a migraine, auditory sensitivity, which means he hears background noise at the same level as any other noises in the vicinity, and olfactory sensitivity, which means that if there are strong smells nearby, he cannot process language at the same speed as within a more smell-neutral environment. This is not a particularly unimaginable scenario, and many PNT who may not understand autism very well might not understand just how genuinely disadvantaged by the environment Alan actually is. The reality, however, is that Alan, despite years of hard graft, is in danger of failing his viva due to adjustments not being made. This is the harsh reality of autistic life for so many people. The PNT do not seem to understand the very real and very devastating impacts of not taking autism and the environment seriously. In Alan's case, as it happened, his supervisor was very familiar with Alan's needs and understood his requirements. One of those requirements that the supervisor had taken upon himself was to show Alan around the room several days prior to the viva, as this would help reduce the anxiety of Alan not being able to visualise the room prior to entering it. As a result of visiting the room, Alan and his supervisor were able to identify the pitfalls of the room allocation. The very simple solution that cost no money was to get an alternative room allocated. Alan passed the viva with no problem at all. This example illustrates a number of things that might cause anxiety, along with what can be done about them, with a clear way forward that is massively impactful on the individual. And yet I hear of so many students for whom such adjustments are summarily ignored. And who knows what long-term damage is being done to those individuals. I am fully of the belief that language and concepts can be massively influential on mental well-being. For example, I know that some autistic adults will not discuss autism with the PNT simply because the level of ignorance and harmful myths that surround autism within Western society are too difficult for them to be exposed to. See Chapter 5 for more on disclosure. I'm sure that many of you will be aware of these kinds of scenarios, so the next few examples and myths are more intended for the reader who is less likely to have been exposed to harmful narrative. Some people, on hearing that you are autistic, will respond with an assertion that it must mean that you are either very good at something, so that makes you a genius at, insert nonsense here, doesn't it? Or else very poor at something, that means you can't have any friends. Or similar. What is problematic isn't quite so much related to the inanity of the assertions themselves, though these are harmful in their own right, but to the very fact that people make the extraordinary assumption that they can judge you as a human being based on aspects of your autism that bear no relation to you. I suggest that a widespread reasonable adjustment that could so easily be picked up is a blanket, never assume anything about a person solely based on their identification of autism. See, how simple would that be, and what a difference it could make? Straight away, if everyone were to buy into this suggestion, disclosure would not risk opening you up to a hurtful narrative. It would increase the chances of the other person making inquiries as to what impact autism has that are specific to you, which is a better way to engage you compared to making assumptions. Throughout the text, I will highlight my favourite adjustments in the hope that one day they can be incorporated into the Autism Act. These are also listed together in the appendix. So, the first on the list is, when someone discloses their autism to you, respond by asking what autism means to them as an individual, rather than making any assumptions based on the autism label itself. Actually, while I am in mind of reasonable adjustments, I shall quickly follow with my second, and it's a potential game changer. When you are engaging with an autistic person, always ask yourself the question, am I doing everything reasonable in my power to identify anxiety and subsequently doing everything I can to reduce or eliminate it? Imagine if this was a dictate that all people adhered to all of the time. The impact it could have, often at no financial cost, is huge. I genuinely believe that there is a lot to be said for promoting the notion that ignoring the fact autism plus environment equals outcome could, in certain circumstances, be unlawful in and of itself. If we can accept that being highly anxious leads to a deterioration of functioning, which it does, then surely this could put you at a significant disadvantage. If you are at a significant disadvantage as a result of your disability in legal terms, and autism is one component of the above equation, so it stands to reason that it is covered under the Equality Act, then not making reasonable adjustments to reduce anxiety could be seen as unlawful. If it is reasonable, for example, to expect those around you to be consciously aware of what might cause you anxiety and subsequently to avoid those triggers, then it would be unlawful for those people not to make those adjustments. In many situations, it really is as simple as that. So, one could argue even that if we as a society have an understanding that environmental factors are likely to increase anxiety for you, then by not making a reasonable effort to ascertain what those factors are, could constitute unlawful action. Consider the following linear progression. 1. Do I understand that environmental factors might cause anxiety for an autistic person? And 3. Have I made a reasonable effort to find out how my actions or inactions might increase anxiety for this autistic person? If the answer to 1 and 2 are a yes, and the answer to 3 is a no, could this mean that I am acting unlawfully? What this means is that knowledge is power. As a society, it is imperative that there is a better understanding of the lawful ramifications for not taking autistic anxiety seriously. Teaching the pretty simple concepts already outlined in this chapter could be a major way forward in the reduction of your anxiety. At least, that's the hope. As noted, I am not legally trained, but my layperson's way of understanding how I could reduce risk of acting inequitably is by asking the following questions. 1. Is this autistic person at a significant disadvantage within her current situation, in which I have some influence, as a result, at least in part, of being autistic? 2. If so, what might I reasonably be expected to do in terms of action to redress that inequality? And 3. Have I made every reasonable effort to act in that manner? If the answers are yes for 1 and no for 3, then I need to consider whether I am acting unlawfully. Here are some very simple examples for consideration. I am not claiming that they are legal examples, but it is worth thinking about them nonetheless. Beatrice is an autistic student within higher education. She has declared being autistic to the university and made it clear that she is processing difficulties with visual materials such as presentations. If she doesn't have access to such material in plenty of time in advance, her anxiety increases and makes the situation even worse. The lecturer decides that her request to make the presentations he uses available a week prior to delivery is too much to ask. In this example, I would suggest that the lecturer is likely to be acting unlawfully. He knows about Beatrice being autistic and that her processing of his materials requires longer compared to her PNT peers. It would appear reasonable to expect him to allow his presentations to be available a week prior to delivering them, and by not doing so could be putting Beatrice at a substantial disadvantage. Carl is an excellent employee who is very effective at his job. However, he steadfastly refuses to join in team meetings in the same vicinity as his colleagues, insisting that he gets far too anxious and that accessing those meetings remotely is just as effective. His anxiety is such that he cannot effectively input into the meetings, whereas in the safety of his own home, he would be relaxed enough to be a productive member of the meeting. His employer is resistant to allowing Carl to do so, saying that it is usual practice for everyone to be in the same room, and it would seem odd if you were not physically present. Again, there could be an argument here that the employer is acting unlawfully. Is Carl at a significant disadvantage? Yes. Would it be reasonable to give Carl the option of being present in a remote capacity rather than physically present? If the answer to this question is yes, then surely he should be allowed that option. Daphne finds supermarkets absolutely overwhelming from a sensory perspective, which means she can only be within one for brief periods of time. Otherwise, she suffers from intense migraine. She makes inquiries about getting placed on the priority list for home delivery slots, but the supermarket refuses, suggesting that the priority slots are there for people who cannot access the store for physical reasons. Once again, one could put forward the case that this is unlawful.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.